Welcome back into the Pick and Roll NBA podcast with Jet and Sap. We are presented, as always, by Full Press Coverage. You can find us on their website, fullpresscoverage.com. We are also on Spotify. We always put our links up on Twitter after the show goes up, so you can catch us there, too. We are available all over the place, so you have no excuse not to listen. I'm joined, as always, by my friend and co-host, John Sapicetti. Sap, how you doing, bud?
I'm doing good, Jet. How are you as we survive a little bit of snow here? You know, we get into February.
It's not a little bit, a lot of snow.
I know, we got a lot of snow. Well, the thing is that depending on where you are, I was lucky the last snowstorm, we only got about 3 or 4 inches because I'm right close to the water. But, you know, I talked to people that were 20 miles away. They got 18 inches, you know, better than me. But, yeah, when you see February and it stays light out a little bit later, you're kind of like, well, spring's not that far away. The Red Sox are going to start training camp at some point. Not that I'm all sold on baseball anymore. It used to be my favorite sport. I'm kind of boycotting it a little bit the last couple of years. But then the snow comes in February, and we get reminded that, you know, winter's going to be around for a little while.
Yeah, it does seem like you get an early February storm to really sort of knock you off your game. You think January, you're like, okay, we've gotten over the hardest month. Sometimes February and March is the hardest month of
yes.
winter.
So, absolutely.
Yeah, we've been pretty bombarded here in the Northeast. I know New York and New Jersey have been hit pretty hard as well with snowstorms. It's been a snowy winter, but as always, we'll survive, even though I think that pretty much daily when you get freezing days and cold days here in the Northeast, you really sort of question your sanity as to why you've chosen to live here. You know, as an adult, there's a whole country of warm places available out there, and yet we've decided to stay in basically the American version of Siberia.
I blame my grandparents. You know, they came from Italy, and, you know, they could have picked somewhere else to go. But of course, when immigrants came back over 100 years ago, which was the case with both sets of grandparents, they didn't really have a choice where they went. They got into Paris Island, Ellis Island. When I talk about Paris Island, Ellis Island, Paris Island is where the Marines go to train. If they had gone to Paris Island, I would have grown up in the, you know, the Carolinas, which may have been better. But so they had really no choice where to go. But Northern California sure would look nice. It's kind of got similar temperatures to Italy. Would have been nice, but they ended up here, and here we
are.
That's
why they can. That's why they grow nice grapes there, right? Italy,
yes,
Northern California.
Northern California is so much like Italy, and that's why you do have some Italians that have settled in Northern Italy. I think Joe DiMaggio, one of the greatest baseball players ever, his family settled in San Francisco. They were fishermen. And but they settled here. So here we are. And I'm too old to move at this point. You're still young enough that, you know, you could say,
I know,
you know,
for some reason I love
else.
It here. I don't know why.
I do think too. There's a lot
it's like,
love.
I must be a masochist, right? Like to deal
yes.
with this is just, you love it in the spring and summer and even the fall, sometimes not too bad. And then in your winter, you're like, man, why do I love it here? What is wrong with me? There must be something actually wrong. Because it's like when there's a lot of snow and it's below freezing, when it's like 18 out and windy, it's oppressive. Like it's just not pleasant in any way, shape, or form. You know, scraping off the snow from your car. I know you don't drive, Sap, but like once it hardens, it's like a workout. It's like trying to get like bricks, wet cement off of a vehicle. So I don't know. Maybe. You have to be a little bit crazy to live here.
You do, and I have a fear of falling because I've fallen a few times and bumped my head a couple years ago, which maybe knocked some sense into me. But, yeah, I have this fear of falling, and then when you get the black ice and, you know, as you get older, you got to be careful of that stuff. But we'll survive. We got plenty of basketball to talk about.
Yeah, that is the good thing is that we do have plenty of basketball to talk about. No more football to talk about as the season concluded with another Tom Brady Super Bowl. That's sort of an evergreen quote you can just say. No one will necessarily know what year you're talking about, but I think you can say it 20 years into the future. People will still say, oh, yeah, he went to the Super Bowl 20 years from now. So now basketball is the main event in the sports world right now. Typically, this is what happens is that the ratings sort of go middle of the ground and then they spike right around when the football season ends because basketball is the only game in town. So a lot of attention will be put on the NBA going forward here towards the end of the year as it has little competition to deal with. Hockey's not particularly popular in the United States compared to basketball. Baseball, as you mentioned, is sort of dying out. So basketball is, I think, taking the place of other sports as the clear number two in the pecking order of North American sports in terms of popularity. And when there's no football right now, it's the the only game in town for a lot of people. So plenty of exciting stuff to come from the rest of the season in the NBA. And right around the corner, believe it or not, even though it seems like the season just started, is the All-Star game, which is generating a lot of controversy. Typically, that would not be the case because the All-Star game is just a exhibition that, you know, players sort of use as an excuse to kind of get together and party and hang out. And, you know, fans watch it casually. No one really cares who wins the game. But this year is different because we are in a pandemic. I don't know if you knew that, Sap, but we are currently in the middle of a pandemic for about a year now.
I hadn't noticed.
Yeah, hadn't noticed. Your lifestyle is the exact same as it was before.
No one told me why I'm supposed to wear a mask. And right. I do. I follow orders. I wear my mask.
That's good. That puts you ahead of a lot of people who were in the government a few weeks ago. So the All-Star game is happening this year as the Players Union negotiated with the NBA League office to put it on. It was not planned at the start of the year, but they have since negotiated it in. And not everybody is particularly happy about that. The leader among them being LeBron James, who upon learning of the All-Star game announcement, had this quote say, Sap, I'm not going to try to do LeBron's voice because I cannot command a room like him. So I'm just going to read the quote in my own voice. I think that's probably the best thing. He said, this was the lead quote here. I have zero energy and zero excitement about an All-Star game this year. So right off the bat, he's just going for the jugular. I don't understand why we're having an All-Star game. Short off season for myself and my teammates, just 71 days. And then coming into the season, we were told we were not having an All-Star game. So we'd have a nice little break, 5 days in March from the 5th to the 10th, an opportunity for me to kind of recalibrate for the second half of the season. My teammates as well, some of the guys in the league, and then they throw an All-Star game on us like this, and it just breaks from the way all the way up top. So I pretty much seems like a slap in the face. Very strong words from LeBron. What were your initial reactions to him sort of going off the cuff and just kind of taking a shot at the league?
Well, he can say whatever he wants to say. He's the biggest star in the league. In fact, a lot of players just follow his lead. And we know, I believe the next day, Giannis said,
yeah, it sort of broke the dam for a lot of people to start talking about it.
Yeah, Giannis said, if the big dog doesn't want to have a game or doesn't want to go, I'm with him. And I think it was also a few other players, De'Aaron Fox, who obviously isn't at the level of Giannis or certainly not LeBron as a star in the league, but he's a young player. He was kind of put off by it because they were told that this wasn't going to happen. We all want to watch this, right, because we love basketball, and I've always loved watching the All-Star game. You see all the different combinations out there, you know, whether it be LeBron in the past playing with Anthony Davis and now he's his teammate with the Lakers, and a lot of the players do a lot of recruiting. Remember a couple of years ago with Kyrie Irving, with Kevin Durant saying two max contracts and yada, yada, yada. You know, 5 months later, they're both in Brooklyn. So that part of it is interesting. But in the middle of a pandemic, maybe it makes sense not to have this. Now, it would take place in Atlanta, which is most of the players, one of their two or three favorite cities to travel to, right? I would think Miami, Los Angeles, and Atlanta, probably the three favorite cities they go to. I think Atlanta, to me, is the African-American entertainment capital of the East, L.A. being
I don't think a lot of them are looking forward to those games in Salt Lake City.
No, I don't think they want to go there. Originally, it was going to be in Indianapolis, which, again, they have some great steakhouses, but, you know, the players can afford to go wherever they want. So I think that with LeBron, he, again, a very short gap between winning the championship in October, starting the next season in December. I'm assuming he's pretty much exhausted mentally and physically. He hasn't missed a game this year. His minutes are down a little bit, but he's not missed a game. I can see that in the middle of this situation, that probably doesn't make a lot of sense to have this game, because you got to be very careful what's going on with the pandemic, that if you get players in this situation, and if there's a lot of fraternizing going on, there's a chance that the numbers will spike. And, you know, I'm assuming that with all the strip clubs in Atlanta, and Atlanta's not open for business. This is not like, say, Boston or New York. Atlanta's open for business. So the players, I'm sure, in some sense would be, yeah, let's go have a good time. Cause it is a great 3 or 4 day event for the players to really kind of have a fun time. It's a convention essentially, but I think that in the middle of this, it probably wouldn't be the wisest thing to do to have players there for 3-4 days or whatever the case may be, probably a little shorter because the festivities aren't going to be as much as they normally are. It's not going to be like a 3-day event. that it does make sense maybe to just hold off on this for 1 year and do it the right way next year. Now, obviously, when LeBron says something, he's the most polarizing athlete in America. People are going to support him, or people are going to say, oh, LeBron, shut up. You know, you're making plenty of money. Just play the damn All-Star game. But when he does speak, people listen, and a lot of the players will follow him. Chris Paul, maybe not one of them, who's the president of the Players Association. And there seems to be some sort of miscommunication.
We're going to get to him in a second.
Little miscommunication between these two players who are really good friends. And at some point, I would love to see them play together, because the basketball IQ with Chris Paul and LeBron James on the court together would be fascinating to watch. But there is a little miscommunication there. And again, sometimes LeBron likes to poke the bear and be passive aggressive. Although in this case, it wasn't really being passive aggressive. He basically said, I have zero interest in this. So from a selfish standpoint, as a fan, I'd love to see it. But I can see where some players would be a little hesitant in this, and maybe let's just pause and do it the correct way a year from now.
Well, let me give you what Chris Paul had to say and sort of the other side of this story. And then I'm going to want you to get off the fence and say one way or the other definitively if you think there should or should not be an All-Star game, okay? No fence sitting on this program.
Are you calling me Glenn Ordway?
I am calling you Glenn Ordway. You have similar physiques.
Well, I'm a little taller, not quite as, you know, stubby. But I think that, no, basically I don't think there should be a game. Because I'm 57, so
you're agreeing with LeBron.
Sensible adult. Yes, if LeBron wanted to play 3 games in 3 days, I'd be all there. In fact,
now let's get to Chris Paul, the president, the duly elected president of the Players Union. No controversy there. There were no recounts. There was no fraudulent voting accused. Chris Paul is in fact the president of the Players Union.
No one stormed the headquarters of the Players Association.
Yeah,
to make
so
sure
this
that
is
got
what
on.
Which is LeBron's house. So this is what Chris Paul, Mr. President, had to say in response to this, because he was asked. Obviously, that was probably the first question he was asked after his post game for the Phoenix Suns. And here's what Chris Paul had to say: guys are entitled to their feelings, decisions, and everything. I think the job for the union has been to try to make sure our players are healthy and safe. This is something that was a decision by the league, and we are definitely day in and day out trying to figure it out. But we have 450 players that we're always trying to get insight from, and it's tough. So we're trying to figure it out right now. You try to over-communicate as much as possible. I talked to LeBron maybe a week or two ago. I talked to Steph Curry, a few other guys, and our executive committee. We get on calls. We try to figure it out. There's different situations. But guys who have been playing a lot of games who haven't really had much of a break, I'm sure I'm not the only guy in the league that lives without a family. And so guys look at that break as an opportunity to see their families. It's a lot of different things going on right now, but you just hope that guys understand that decisions that are being made, especially as far as the union, has always got the full body of players in mind, but emotions happen. Guys have feelings and you have to be able to express them. And I respect that. So basically Chris Paul is in charge of representing every single player in the league. Not just LeBron James, not just the superstars. And to a larger point in what Chris Paul is saying, the revenue made from the All-Star game, from the television broadcast and the international broadcasts, that goes into a big pool that determines the salary cap. So the more money you add to that pool, the more money that can be distributed amongst all players, not just LeBron James, not just Steph Curry, not just Chris Paul, but, you know, the Carson Edwards is of the world, the Miles Plumleys of the world, the guys who, you know, are on lesser contracts. Chris Paul is responsible for making sure every player in the NBA is able to make as much money as possible. That's his primary responsibility to his constituents, which are the 450 players that make up the NBA Players Union. And he feels, as does the rest of the executive committee, which has like 8 vice presidents, Jaylen Brown of the Celtics being among them. Kyrie Irving, I believe, is another one from the Nets. Mm-hmm. They feel, whether it's unanimous or not, that putting on this All-Star game and the revenue being made from the All-Star game is more beneficial to the bulk of the league than to not have it due to, you know, players wanting to rest to their families, the health risks, whatever associated with that. And I think that it's important to remember that while the NBA is very much a star-driven league and the guys like LeBron and Chris Paul and Steph Curry and Kevin Durant, you know, drive the interest in the league, when you're talking about a union, you can't just represent the highest paid people who are working in that union. You have to take to you need to take into account the guy who's making the least amount of money just as much as the guy who's making the most amount of money. If that's if it's a true union, that's sort of the point, is to protect everybody. And so I think Chris Paul is just doing what he feels is the most responsible thing to do for the amount of lost revenue there was this season or and last season because of the pandemic. So I actually think Chris Paul is making the right decision. He's been accused before of placating the stars in the league too much. There's far more non-stars in the NBA than there are stars. I know all we talk about are the star players, but it's, again, 450 players that are making up the league, and the amount of max contract players is just a very small percentage of that. So I think that I agree with Chris Paul's point here. I mean, he didn't come out and say, you know, LeBron, you have to think about the little guy, because I don't think he wanted to, you know, embarrass his friend or anything like that. But if you read between the lines, that's more or less what Chris Paul had to say.
No, I mean, very good points on Chris Paul's part. But again, as you said, there's 450 players in the league. And I know people call it a union. It's more of an association. I can't join the NBA Players Association. I would like to. You know, I'd love the benefits, but I can't join it. You have to be an NBA player. But with 450 players in this association, only 24 would be partaking in the All-Star weekend or the All-Star right. game, because it's not going to be a normal weekend. There's not going to be all
the pomp and circumstance. No, it's like a fly in, play the game, fly out.
Right. Yeah, probably one overnight. And that's the way it used to be years ago. I actually went to an NBA All-Star game in 1982 at Brendan Byrne Arena where the Nets played. And it was great, but we drove down Saturday, went to practice Saturday afternoon, and went back to the game Sunday. I think tap off was at 1 o'clock in the afternoon, and then we drove back to Boston. Got to interview the players. I was, you know, freelancing for ESPN at the time. It was great. Great time. That's probably more what they're going to do this time around. It's going to be, you know, in one day, stay overnight game, go home. So there shouldn't be too much exposure. And if you could put protocols in place, then that's good. You know, but is James Harden going to follow protocols?
No.
Is he going to find his favorite strip club in Atlanta? Probably a lot of the players will still do that. A lot won't. I don't think maybe LeBron visits it or Chris Paul. I mean, maybe the older guys don't. Maybe they want to. Who knows? But the point is only 24 players would be impacted by this if they're so chosen to play. The other 426 players, whether it's Carson Edwards or Miles Plumlee or whoever, they don't have to make that decision because they're not going to be selected to play in the All-Star game. And now I don't know what the numbers are. Is it $20 million? Is it $40 million? Half of that money goes back to the owners, half goes to the players. So obviously let's say it's $10 million that goes back to the players. And I'm just throwing numbers out there. What does that mean for 450 players? I think it's about $22,000. If my math is correct, about $22,000.
I'm not the person to ask that question.
Yeah. Yeah. Just 10 million divided by 450 is about $22,000 per player, which, you know, nothing to scoff at, even if you're, you know, a low level player, but they could probably find that somewhere else without having to put players in danger. And again, as we learned, even at the bubble last year, I forget, it was one of the Clippers. It might've been Pat Beverly who said, if LeBron wants to play in the bubble and have the playoffs, that's what we're going to do. And it was looked at as kind of a sarcastic comment, but it was true. He does run the league to a certain extent. I know Chris Paul's the president, but LeBron sets the temperature. I'm sure there are many players that have access to the commissioner. And I think we both agree that Adam Silver is the best commissioner of the four major sports. Doesn't have to beat a lot of really good candidates to be that guy, but he is. I'm sure, you know, there's a handful of players that he reaches out to. And if LeBron has a concern, he'll get in touch with Adam Silver. I'd love to see the game. You would too. We're both huge fans of this. The player's going to be into this. What type of product is it going to be? And are we putting them in harm's way? Because this schedule, you know, there's been some games that have been lost. They're going to have to work on the second half of the schedule to get through this. Because the way to handle this pandemic, and I know people bashed the NHL last year because they didn't look like they had a plan, but they got through it. You have to be very, very fluid with this. You can't just throw out, well, here's the schedule, be damned. You have to do it incrementally. And the NFL did. Yeah, the NFL was like, we're doing this no matter what, whether we need to have a guy that was working at UPS quarterback the Denver Broncos in midseason and have the entire Baltimore Ravens team, you know, in quarantine and have them play the Steelers with first place at stake in the AFC North. The other sports, you kind of did it in stages because you have to see what's going on and how you're handling it. Like, is Atlanta open for business now? But maybe in 3 or 4 weeks, it's not. And it's not the best place to have the game. So much of this is fluid. I would love to see the game, but I could see the concerns with LeBron. And again, he runs the league. So, you know, the game is in jeopardy unless Chris Paul and some of the other star players say, LeBron, you know, you blurted out what you wanted to, you know, let's get you back here and let's have the game. Maybe he doesn't go to it, which would kind of surprise me. But yeah, maybe that's his way of protesting, saying, hey, look, I need 5 days off. I would admire that more than what we've seen, you know, Kyrie Irving do, which is miss the games before the All-Star game, go to the All-Star game, and then miss games after the All-Star game. Which
in retrospect, that was a red flag for the Celtics.
Yeah, at that point. Yeah, you call me, it's like, this guy's more interested in the All-Star game than our own important games before and after the All-Star break. And this used to happen in baseball. There were certain players that wouldn't play for three or four games leading up to the All-Star break, and then you'd see them at the All-Star game, and then they take a couple more games off. I'm like, well, why, you know, you play for your team, not for your league and your All-Star game. It's a little bit selfish, but it is interesting to see what happens. And it's interesting to see that LeBron and Chris Paul, you know, two of the best leaders in the sport, you know, kind of on different sides. And I think Chris Paul handled this really well. That read like a statement of someone who understands how to handle different situations. You know, he wasn't bombastic at all.
It's really interesting that from my perspective, he used to drive me crazy, Chris Paul, up until the bubble where I saw him drag that pretty crappy Thunder team to winning. And then everything he did to put the bubble together and keep it together. He's a remarkable union president. I mean, absolutely. Really, really amazing at his job. I have completely 180'd on Chris Paul. I respect him. I mean, I've always respected his game. He's a tremendous player, but like his ability to, this has been probably the hardest time to be a union leader in the NBA with the pandemic. And he's been able to make sure his players have, for the most part, kept safe and healthy and get paid. I think he's done it, you know, despite a lot of people vocally, big name players like Kyrie Irving and now LeBron James, you know, vocally opposing his efforts at times, he's been able to do what he thinks and what I think has financially proven to be the best thing for his constituents. I really can't say enough about the leadership of Chris Paul off the court as a union president. I think he's done a tremendous job. And I think that the league has really, really benefited from his leadership, and that it also goes the other way too. I think Adam Silver, representing the league's interests, is a reasonable negotiator. You need to have reasonable negotiators on both sides. That's what we see the problem in government today, is you don't have people operating in good faith for negotiations. You see it happen in baseball all the time. The players and the league don't agree on anything, won't agree on anything. Can't even agree on something as simple as a pitch clock. So in the NBA, I think you have to give a lot of credit to Chris Paul being a smart and reasonable negotiator and having the best interests of the entire league in mind. And I think that it's a fair criticism that I've heard a little bit of people, that LeBron has now been so famous and so wealthy for so long now, it's easy to forget about those guys who are not making a full-on set-for-life living in the NBA. You know, those guys who are on 10-day contracts or are on minimum contracts, it's still a nice chunk of change, but it doesn't have you set for life. LeBron and his kids and grandkids were set for life 10 years ago. You know, everything else he's been adding is cherry on top of that. So I think it's easy to forget sort of the little guy in the NBA or the little guy in the union when you've been on top of the mountain making just unbelievable amounts of money and have unbelievable amounts of fame for, you know, the better part of 20 years now. So I think that I am impressed that Chris Paul is able to keep that in mind, but that's sort of his job as union president. I think that LeBron maybe has kind of forgotten about those guys a little bit and is playing to his own interests, which is fine. That's his prerogative. No one's saying he's not the president of the Players Association. He's not responsible for those players. But I think you could look at it and say, as a member of the Players Association, you know, maybe you make the sacrifice and play one game in Atlanta to help the other guys, you know, out. I don't have full finances on it, but there was a report today that Turner in ad revenue alone clears $30 million from the All-Star game. So there's a lot of money to be made from the game. You know, people have looked at it as sort of a joke recently, but it's a big revenue driving event. And so I think that, you know, there's obviously always two sides to every story. I think that Chris Paul is handling this the right way. LeBron, maybe now that he vented, will be a little bit more quiet about it. Mm-hmm. But I do feel like if I was a veterans minimum guy in the NBA or a 10-day contract guy, I'd say, well, one, I don't have to play in the game, so who cares? And two, this would really help me out. You know, any extra money that gets added to the pot will be helpful financially.
And I think with LeBron, too, like you said, you know, he's incredibly wealthy. Estimated value of his net worth is $600-700 million. I mean, eventually he'll be a billionaire and not too far away from that, because, you know, a player like that with endorsements, investments and everything probably makes well over $100 million a year. So you do lose a little bit of touch with, like you said, the rank and file in your union, especially those players that are on minimum salaries and are just, you know, so happy to be in the league. And that does happen. That's just, that's human nature. I mean, that, whether it's, you know, I'm sure Tom Brady, as great as he is, probably lost a little touch with reality, because they're so, they're huge. They're corporations. I mean, they both spend over $2 million a year on their body. They have live-in chefs. I mean, they're not living in the real world. So sometimes when they look at things, they kind of lose touch. That's why oftentimes, they know, people that work in restaurants, the last people they want to see come in are wealthy people, because they don't tip. They don't even understand the concept of giving a good tip. Whereas, you know, people that work in the service industry will get better tips from a cab driver or a truck driver, someone who actually, you know, has to work really hard and, you know, has to struggle every week to pay their bills. They're more apt to leave a 20, 25% tip for a server, whereas a wealthy person, this doesn't even comprehend it. So sometimes you lose touch with reality.
Yeah. And I think there's a little bit of, that's what's happening here too. And, you know, he's the biggest athlete on the planet. And has been for a while now. And so he knows his own power, that when he says anything he says is a news story. And especially if he's going to make such a direct statement about an All-Star game, you know, he's going to have to know that resonates. And if I were a rank and file NBA player, that would irk me a little bit, knowing that, hey, this is a effort to take some money out of my pocket inadvertently. Right.
Yeah.
No, so it's interesting. I think the game, you know, it's going to end up being played because they more or less have an agreement. Whether they allow opt-outs for the game is going to be what will be interesting to see. Because that is interesting. I would feel that a lot of players would take advantage of that opt-out.
He'll play. LeBron will play because I think he likes the attention.
He might get pressured too by, you know, Chris Paul saying, hey, I mean, you kind of threw me under the bus here a little bit. Can you, show up?
What's the ad revenue without LeBron James? And what's the ad revenue with LeBron James? More, right? So, I mean, he is that X factor. I mean, if Bradley Beal decides to opt out, fine. But if LeBron James decides to opt out, well, it's major
news.
It's
a bigger deal. Absolutely.
It leads ESPN and Fox Sports One, you know, on their shows.
There's a reason why he plays the most national TV games every year and has for about 20 years now.
Yep.
Yeah, he's a draw. He's the draw. He's the biggest draw in basketball. He's arguably the biggest draw in sports. So we've been talking a lot about, you know, these guys who are, you know, modern NBA superstars, LeBron being the sort of the perfect example of it. And he's actually played like through two generations of these guys. And we've talked before about sort of rivalry between these old players, especially the guys on TNT, Shaq, Charles Barkley, and the younger players now who kind of don't like to take criticism and feel like they're being attacked. And there's a lot of sentiment amongst the old players that the game was better in my, this isn't just basketball. This isn't unique to basketball. This is every sport. The game was better in my day. No way you could play in my day. When I played, this was when the sport was at its height. So that's what you've heard a lot from Barkley and Shaq. And, you know, the players obviously take issue with that. But somebody who kind of came from that last generation and is considered one of the great players of all time and one of the more tough players of all time, at least verbally, Kevin Garnett, who is one of my all-time favorite players, if not my all-time favorite player, not just Celtic, just player in general. He went the other way and was extraordinarily complimentary of today's game, to the point we're saying basically the opposite, that guys from the last generation, the Barkleys, the Shaqs, they wouldn't be able to hack it in today's NBA. This is what Garnett had to say in New York Times Magazine. He was being talked about, just talking about basketball in general. He said, the game is at another level. I want you to get on a court, sprint corner to corner, stop on a dime and shoot a three. I want you to do 10 of those. Then I want you to focus on how tired you are, because these players do that for 48 minutes. I don't think guys from 20 years ago could play in this game. 20 years ago, guys used to use their hands to control players. Now you can't use your hands. That makes defense damn near impossible. Can you imagine not hand-checking Michael Jordan? No, the fact that you can't touch players gives the offensive players so much flexibility. Defensive players have to take angles away and stuff like that. But if you have any creativity and ambition, you can be a great offensive player in this league. The fadeaways, one-leg runners, the one-leg balance shots, that stuff that Dirk Nowitzki brought to our game. And now I watch Nikola Jokic play, and it feels like he is taking that Dirkness and mixed it with his own talent. Steph Curry revolutionized things with being able to shoot it from distance with such consistency. Klay Thompson, Dame Lillard, those guards changed the game. I don't know if even the guards from 20 or 30 years ago could play this time right now. It's creative, it's competitive, it's saucy. You'll get dropped. A Emmer Effer, which he actually said because he's Kevin Garnett, will cross you over and break your ACL these days. The game is in a great place. That was about as complimentary and ebullient as an older generation player can be about the younger generation of the league. What were your sort of takeaways from Garnett? Were you surprised to hear it from him?
Yeah, I was surprised, pleasantly surprised, because I didn't play in the NBA, watched a lot of games in person on TV, but I love what he said there, because I think the league is in the best place it's ever been. I think the skill level is through the roof. And when people talk about that no one's playing defense, as Garnett said, just imagine chasing someone from corner to corner for 48 minutes. Imagine trying to cover Steph Curry. He's constant motion, and he's a threat to score from 35 feet in. So we had this conversation before, and I got really long-winded about it, that today an NBA basketball team has to cover 50 feet, which is the width of the court, multiplied by at least 30, maybe 35 feet out. You know, so we're talking 1,500 to 1,650 square feet that a team has to cover. When Bird and Magic and Jordan and Kobe, you know, were playing at their peak, you know, they didn't have to cover corner threes like they do now. So they probably had to cover maybe 40 feet, the width of the court, and maybe 25 feet out. And that's probably a bit much. That's about 1,000 square feet. So now you're asking players have to cover essentially 50 to 60% more of the court than they had to 20, 25 years ago. This would be like if you just made the football field a lot bigger. Could you picture trying to cover these great wide receivers? They'd have all sorts of room to roam. Imagine, you know, Tyreek Hill playing on a longer and wider football field. It would be insane. And you still have 11 players, 11 on 11. So I'm so happy that Garnett said that, because you hear it all the time. You know, Barkley, well, I would have dominated. And you know what? Barkley would play today. He'd be great today. Those great players from 20, 30 years ago would be great today. They'd figure it out. But I go back and look at some of the All-Star teams from like 20 years ago. And look at the All-Star teams now, and there'll be players that will not make this All-Star team, if there's an All-Star game, that are better than the guys that made those All-Star teams.
Oh, yeah, you could have a third team that would be really good.
Yeah, like Vin Baker and Eddie Jones. I mean,
Jamal McGlure made an All-Star game.
Right. You know, good players. Yeah, right. Good players. But they're like, there's guy. I mean, Bradley Beal didn't make the All-Star team last year, right? I mean, Devin Booker. Did he not make it the year before or whatever? I'm like, These are like really great players. They didn't even make it. The skill level today is much higher. And I just think that you also have a bigger talent pool, right? Because up until Dirk, you know, the foreign players weren't as advanced as they are now. Now you just look at the All-Star team. You're going to have, you know, Joker, you're going to have Luka, you're going to have Giannis. I mean, these are European players. You didn't have the vast,
Embiid from Africa. Greatness of today.
Embiid from Africa. Yeah. I mean, it's crazy. Canada, I mean, produces better players. I mean, Andrew Wiggins is not an all-star, but he's actually from Canada. Ben Simmons.
He's from Australia.
Australia, yeah. Steve Nash, who, of course, went
back
to
the NBA. Jamal Murray's from Canada.
Jamal Murray's from, yeah, a lot of really great players. So before, it was pretty much, you know, the United States of America. And then they expanded the league by six teams in about an eight-year period, and it really got watered down. That's why I always push back with the Jordan being the greatest player of all time, because he did dominate kind of a post-expansion league without a lot of foreign players. So you could win championships with, you know, Jordan, Pippen, and a lot of role players. That probably wouldn't work today. So I'm very proud of Garnett for saying that, because the easy way out would be, well, in my day, you know, pound the table and make it sound like, you know, he would have shut down every player that's out there today. Give him credit for a real nuanced approach there, and I like that.
Do you think that it resonates with some of the older players? Like, wow, if Garnett says this, like, maybe I should take look at my position?
No. I mean, they're set in their ways. You think this Charles Barkley is going to read this? And I love Charles Barkley. I think their, pre and post game show is the best in all of TV, whether it's football, basketball, anything. That is sensational. When him and Barkley go at it and Kenny Smith tries to be the reasonable one and Ernie Johnson's a great host. But no, those Barkley and Shaq, they're not backing down from their thoughts that, that today's players are softer. I mean, could Shaq even get up and down the court in today's game? I mean, seriously, no. Shaq was never in the best of shape. Barkley didn't exactly take care of himself either. I mean, either one of those guys were workout warriors. Shaq famously said, I'll start working out when training camp starts. Or if I need to have an operation, I'm doing it in your time, not my time. Barkley battled weight throughout his entire career. So, the level of professionalism and determination is phenomenal, to the point where when you occasionally see a player that appears to be a little bit out of shape, like Joel Embiid, he gets called on that. Or Zion Williamson has to kind of redo his body. You don't see many NBA players that you look at and say, that guy doesn't look like he's totally committed to his craft.
Yeah, and I think that, the technology is so good now, and there's, the science is so is so good and so heavily invested by teams to, have this, staff of elite nutritionists and doctors and dietitians and stuff like that. So, I mean, teams spend a lot of money on that sort of stuff. Yeah. So it's kind of, I think, when Barkley started playing in like the late 80s, it was kind of like, figure it out on your own. Go to the local gym, YMCA and work out, have, it's your responsibility. Now there's no excuse to be out of shape in the NBA. Absolutely none. Everything is provided for you to be in the best shape you could possibly be in, and paid for. I think that it goes both ways, though. I look at it, and I agree with Garnett wholeheartedly that this is by far the most talent the NBA has had. It's foolish to think otherwise. It's not close. It's every team, for the most part, has a guy who you could make a case would be is an all-star or borderline all-star caliber player. Mm-hmm. I mean, really, almost virtually every team has a guy who's a really good basketball. Like, look at the Knicks.
Yeah.
Their best player is probably Julius Randle. He's not an all-star. Mm-hmm. He's a really, really good basketball player. I mean, you can't deny he's a really, really good basketball player. And he's in the past, one of the worst teams in the league would have a guy that is their best player is like in the Celtics in the early 90s, their best player was Dino Raja, Brown. I mean, those guys would be end of the roster. I mean, no offense to them. I know Dino Raja's in the Basketball Hall of Fame more as a contributor. Those guys would be at best seventh, eighth men. Now, it's just the league is in such a good place in terms of talent. It's not close. And it makes logical sense, right? The more that the population grows and that the league grows internationally and that other sports like baseball take sort of a back seat and football, less people are maybe willing to play because of the concussion stuff, that the talent pool would grow. That makes logical sense.
Isn't it a sense too that like Tiger Woods elevated golf, he became the first golfer that worked out year round. He got in great shape. He would have the LASIK surgery on his eyes. I mean, he did everything to get the most out of his ability so that every other golfer had to go that route to compete with Tiger Woods. We see that in the NFL. The quarterbacks now are all following the lead of Tom Brady. Guys like Russell Wilson and Aaron Rodgers have changed their diet because they look at Tom Brady at 43 still winning Super Bowls, and Rodgers is 37 and Wilson's 32, and they're like, hey, I want to play another 5-10 years, so I got to take care of myself in the offseason. That's why I think like quarterback playing in the NFL is at the highest it's ever been.
Because human evolution sap is bigger, faster, stronger.
Look at Justin Herbert. Now, I'm in the market for my future next favorite quarterback. Yeah. Aaron's going to be my guy till he retires. Herbert might be that guy. He's 6'6", 240.
We're accepting invitations to the all right,
Justin Herbert's probably the front runner at this point. But
I know a dirty little secret, Sep, that a couple years ago you said your front runner was Carson Wentz.
I'm off that. I'm off that, man. I was wrong about that. But Herbert is 6'6", 240 with a rocket arm. And, oh, by the way, a 4.0 grade point average. And we could see he's going to be a superstar. At least I think so. But everything's gotten better. And now in the NBA, LeBron's the trendsetter, right? Because LeBron spends $2 million a year on his body. He's constantly working out.
Except it's so just now, how it goes. It's natural. It's life. If you, yeah. you need a perfect example, look at the Olympic records. Every year they yep. get broken by the next yep. crop of Olympians. Every 4 years, rather, they get yep. broken by the next crop of Olympians because they get better at training. Science gets better. Sure. Technology gets better. The people are bigger, faster, stronger. It's just that's yep. that's how that's it simple. Goes. It's and it's not something that's been slow moving. It's every couple of years you get more talent added to the pool. The yep. guys, the cream rises to the top, as the Macho Man Randy Savage would say. and so you have right now in 2021, by far, and I love old school basketball stuff. I'm sure. not by any means somebody who says, oh, the game sucked back there. I think it's great. I grew up with 90s basketball, but I'm also realistic. It's the best, the most amount of talent the league has had. It's no not question. Close. I love Jordan. I think he's the greatest player ever. I am not on the LeBron is greater than Jordan camp at all. I will die on the Jordan Hill. LeBron's played against better talent, period. I can't argue that. It's illogical to argue it. It's like the same people who are still saying, well, Joe Montana is better than Tom Brady. That has since passed. It's gone. There's right. no argument to be made anymore. The league has the most talent it's ever had. I fully agree with Garnett there. I will say this, though. Counter his point. I do think also if you were to take a Steph Curry or a whoever and drop them into the league 20, 30 years ago, they might have a more difficult time playing because there was hand checking. I'm not saying mm-hmm. they would be worse, but the rules are slightly different. And so the players then would maybe struggle a little bit more now, and the players now might struggle sure. a little bit more then. That's just how it goes. But it doesn't change the fact that the players now are more athletic. They're better shooters. They're better dribblers. They're faster. They're bigger. They're stronger. That's just a Everything. Fact.
Yeah, and again, their skill level within the game is higher because they've spent more time doing it, right? You know, AAU, I'm not a huge fan of, but these guys are coming in with a lot of reps. We've talked about this.
Against extremely high-level talent.
Exactly. We talk about this in any business. If you're an attorney, the more you get in front of a judge and a jury, you get better as a trial attorney. In radio, the more you host shows, the better you get. You know, it's reps. You know, a lot of people say you need 10,000 hours to really start to hit your peak, whether you're a radio talk show host, a lawyer, whatever the case may be. Basketball as well, these guys are so well schooled, and it goes back to the quarterbacks as well. These quarterbacks in seventh and eighth grade are going to quarterback school, so they're hyper focused on what they're going to do, kind of like Olympians.
D1 offers for fifth graders from yeah. like Alabama and USC.
Yep. Nick Saban's, you know, he's going to middle school to recruit for the Alabama Crimson Tide. So, yeah, this is I give Garnett a ton of credit there because I think every older guy, and he always does come across as in the past of, you know, the get off my lawn guy. But
well, he did enough. When he rejoined the Timberwolves in 2015. He took every player's phones and flushed them on the toilet. So
Magic Johnson did that when he was coaching the Lakers. He came back and cell phones were going off, and he started breaking them. You know, it was just like, are we here to concentrate on basketball?
Yeah, Garnett still probably has a flip phone, is my guess.
Oh, I probably that big giant phone that Michael Douglas had in Wall Street. You know, yeah. You need two hands to hold on to, or they bring it to you in the restaurant. No, but good for Garnett, and I think it's great. But Shaq and Barkley aren't going to back down. They're going to go forward with, you know, their crazy old man.
I think the
routine,
best argument
I love.
The best argument for guys like Shaq and Barkley to make, and it's an argument that I agree with, is that the players now are too sensitive. I think that's sure. a totally fair yep. argument, and I think that is part of the AAU stuff. They're yep. way more sensitive than the players were in the 90s. I mean, they were getting into brawls on the court in the 90s.
Yep.
Look at the Knicks and the Heat and the Pacers and stuff like that. Those teams were very physical. I don't think the players would be okay with that now. It wouldn't deal with it well. Wouldn't deal with getting criticism. They just don't deal with criticism very well.
No.
That's, I think, a fair point to make about today's players. But to say that the game is harder, was harder when they played back then, is wrong, because there's just more talent now. So the game should be more difficult when you're playing against better players.
Those guys dealt with different stuff. The local columnist.
Yeah, there's no social media. I get that.
Right. The back in the 80s and 90s, the local columnist was the person that you followed, right? So whatever, if they came out and attacked players, that was the tough part. But then the local columnist would have to show up to the game. Now it's more about talk radio, and the talk radio, sports talk radio hosts don't show up to the game so they can bloviate from afar. But also, you know, ESPN has around the clock sports in terms of of talking heads, right? You've got Get Up, and then you've got First Take, and you go on and on. There's ESPN Radio. You got Fox Sports One that's got, you know, 11 straight hours of live TV where everybody's got all their takes going. So the players are sensitive, and they listen more. I think back in the day, they probably players read the newspaper, maybe listened to a little talk radio, which was not as big as it is now. Right. I mean, there was one talk radio station in Boston, and it wasn't really a full-time talk radio station. Then EEI grew into that, and then you had the Sports Hub into it. So, yeah, the players are a little certainly more sensitive. And I think Adam Silver talked about that last year. He goes, why are my players so unhappy? You know, they're making plenty of money. They live a good life, but they're not happy. A lot of it is that social media interaction. And nobody worse at that than Kevin Durant, who has burner accounts and fights with people with 12 followers. I mean, that's kind of a waste of time, you know, on his case. But, you know, it doesn't stop him from being an absolutely exquisite basketball player.
Yeah, I think, you know, obviously with every generation, you can learn from the generation before you, and you can learn from the current generation. You know, I think Barkley and Shaq, if they from a pure basketball perspective, could learn some new basketball, plenty of new basketball skills from these guys who are so, and these guys maybe could learn how to handle criticism a little bit better than Barkley and Shaq. We talked, I think last week it was about like when Patrick Ewing in college came to the Garden and was hearing, you know, racial epithets hurled at him every which way for the entire length of the game. It's totally inappropriate and unacceptable, but I doubt he had a bad game. I'm sure it didn't affect him.
He was from here. That was the crazy. I mean, everything was about that was crazy. Cause I went to the Georgetown BC game, which they'd always have at the Garden, you know, cause you needed to find a place with more seats
than Conte Forum.
Georgetown was the biggest draw in the sport at that point. And here's a guy from Cambridge, the next city over from Boston. He went to Georgetown, which was the right decision. He learned to play under John Thompson. He won a national championship. Heck, he learned from a coach who learned from Bill Russell. So if you're a big man, you can't get any better than that. And here he is in his hometown. Jet, it would never happen today. It was disgusting. You know, they had people went in with banana peels, gorilla masks, and this kid who at the time was 19 is at the free throw line. What does he think at that point? You know, that I'm sure that's either going to toughen you up or make you want to just quit the sport. And obviously, right. Ewing was a tough.
And I'm not saying anybody should have to handle or deal with anything like that. But I'm just saying that there was a degree of like they could deal with stuff better. Like, for example, last year Kyrie Irving didn't come to Boston. People chanted, "Where's Kyrie?" and booed him. And he put out he wasn't even there. And he put out like a long statement on Instagram being like, life is more than basketball. He couldn't even handle being booed when he wasn't there. So it's a different mentality. So I do think, you know, with all aspects of life, there's a want from the prior generations to want to put down the current generation.
Yep.
Also a want from the current generation to say, I don't have use for you. You're old and you're just bitter.
Yep.
When really, you probably have more in common than you think, and you could certainly learn from each. So it was interesting to hear Garnett sort of cross the picket line here, if you would, and be overly complimentary of today's players. And I think he was dead on. And I also, he is somebody who I think you could drop in any era and be able to play.
Absolutely.
Because he had a very unique skill set and probably would be able to defend people, you know, however many square feet you said, 1,500, 1,600.
He would be a guy. I've turned into like a real estate agent at this point trying to explain.
And was always in tremendous shape, too. So,
yeah. Oh, right. Yeah. There's a guy who obviously took his craft very seriously. Yeah. These great players could drop into any situation. Larry Bird today would be phenomenal. He'd take
I'm saying, like, Shaq would be great, obviously, today. He'd be asked to do more, be asked to do different things. Yeah. He couldn't just sit in the post. Shape. They wouldn't be okay. They wouldn't be okay with someone just staying down there. He'd have to have some sort of a jumper.
And he would end up at the foul line even more than he did. And he, not a very good free throw shooter. And Barkley would evolve. The great players would be fine. Magic Johnson would be great in this era. Larry Bird would be great in this era. We obviously know Jordan and LeBron would be great in any era because they're, in addition to being the two greatest players, they're also like the two most versatile guys because they can also do it on the defensive end. So, fascinating stuff. And it's good when you hear some of the older guys appreciate today's players. I mean, Ted Williams always appreciated the modern hitters. He always did. I mean, who can forget at the 99 All-Star game when he was nearly blind, but he was in that golf cart and all the All-Stars came up to him and he was asking them all questions. And McGuire, Mark McGuire, he said to Mark McGuire, he goes, when you foul one off and just miss it, you smell the wood burning. And McGuire goes, yeah. And that was just fantastic because he really appreciated McGuire and Sosa, and Tony Gwynn was one of his favorite guys. And he kept telling Tony Gwynn, don't be afraid to pull the ball, show some power. And Tony Gwynn started to hit some home runs. So I love when the old players embrace and appreciate today's players rather than be the bitter old guy.
Yeah. And it's, I mean, I don't, like you said, I don't think Barkley or Shaq are going to back off anytime soon or ever.
No.
Also, you know, it generates talking points and ratings, and that at this point, that's their job, is to get interest. So, it is, unique again to see someone cross the picket line, but maybe you'll see more players, sort of be willing to be more complimentary of today's game. And, you know, especially because you see it with Tom Brady and LeBron James, you know, you're witnessing something that is just unlikely to ever happen again, but I guess you never know. So it's sort of appreciate while you got it. Before we end the show, Sap, we've been usually doing our top five teams, but since we did a podcast the other days ago, I don't think either of our top five would have changed. So I'm going to ask you about a couple of teams, and I'm going to have you put your money where your mouth is and say, how far will they go in the postseason? As they are right now, I think everybody's anticipating some trades by the trade deadline. Nothing, probably no huge names like James Harden early in the season getting moved from team to team, but maybe some trades that will shake up the top of the standings. So let's start with the Eastern Conference and the Milwaukee Bucks, who have been trying desperately to get to the NBA Finals for the past few years. How far can they go right now as they are currently constituted?
I still think Philadelphia is better than they are, and I think Brooklyn will be better than they are. So I think they can get to the second round, and then they'll lose to one of those two teams. Now, again, you have to play this out and see where the seedings are because, you know, they may avoid one of these teams in the second round. If Brooklyn, which they're not totally committed on the regular season, they have a lot of load management. Durant's out again with COVID concerns, and Kyrie Irving has his own schedule. So, you know, the Nets could fall to like four and have to play, say, Philadelphia in the second round. So one of them gets knocked out. So Milwaukee could make it to the conference finals. Is this going to be the year where Milwaukee doesn't put up an extraordinary regular season but is built better for the postseason?
I was going to say that, Sep. I kind of feel like this is the perfect scenario for Milwaukee. Everybody is talking about Brooklyn and Philadelphia. Mm-hmm. The past few years, it was Milwaukee was, I mean, 10 games ahead of everybody else for most of the season in first place. I mean, just like lapping the field. And even people were talking about Toronto, you know, the past couple of years too, and Milwaukee. But Milwaukee with Giannis winning back-to-back MVPs, I mean, that's everybody expected them to go to the finals. They had the best record 2 years in a row. They've had the best record in the NBA, not just the Eastern Conference. I feel like being under the radar might benefit them this year. You feel a little bit less pressure. They're a better team this year with Drew Holiday than they have been the past couple of years. Maybe they're pacing themselves a little bit. They still have, I think, the second best record in the Eastern Conference. But being under the radar, maybe that's good for them.
Yeah, it could be. And you also get the feeling with Milwaukee the last 2 years, and after we see this played out in the postseason, that they felt a little bit like the Cavaliers when LeBron was there the first time around, where they had the great player who was winning MVPs, like LeBron won two MVPs in Cleveland. But when you get to the postseason, there wasn't enough there, and the great player had to learn how to win in the postseason. Right now, LeBron's learned to do that. I don't think Giannis can ever get to that level because he just doesn't have the breadth of skill that LeBron has. I mean, is Giannis going to wake up and all of a sudden be a better shooter, better ball handler? You know, I think he is what he is. But yeah, that could be the case. And again, we'll have to see what happens at the trade deadline, which is March 25th. And like you said, is there going to be a big player that drops in the trade deadline? I mean, we all keep talking about Bradley Beal. You know, he could be a guy.
Yeah, I don't think he's going anywhere.
Elevate you through, but it doesn't appear that he's going to go anywhere at this point because he still has, what, 2 years left on his contract after this year. So it's doubtful that he gets moved. But, you know, there'll be some players that get moved. And if Milwaukee can add someone, then I think that they could be a surprise team in the East when we're not expecting it, which again, perfectly, as you said, Jet, expectations being a little bit low, they can fly under the radar. Giannis, I don't think, is going to win the MVP again this year.
He'll have pretty much the same numbers.
He'll have pretty much the same numbers. It's almost like, you know, MVP fatigue. It's just, you know, now there's Joel Embiid or LeBron or Jokic appear to be the three favorites. So, that could be the case. Milwaukee fly under the radar. And and just, you know, surprise people. And again, a lot of it has to do with happens with seedings. Like I said, if you're the Celtics, you want to avoid, I mean, the worst case scenario for the Celtics would be them fourth and Brooklyn fifth or something like that. And you're going to face them in the first round. And Milwaukee, if they're in that 2-3-6-7 grouping, they can avoid all the top teams and maybe slide into the conference finals.
Well, then let's talk about the Celtics then, Sap. How far can they go as currently constituted? I can't answer this question fairly. I'm being realistic about myself. I watch too much of them. I'm too invested to be able to realistically assess them.
So you've got Jason Tatum and Jaylen Brown, brilliant young stars. There's no question about that. They're both all-star players. They both should, if there is an all-star game, they should both be in Atlanta. After that, it's just a lot of question marks. And Kemba Walker has not looked good. And I don't think he's going to all of a sudden magically get healthier as the season goes on. Their big man rotation is frustrating, right? With Tristan Thompson and Daniel Tice. And then you see Robert Williams. Like, I'm not sure how that all fits together. You don't have Marcus Smart now for probably another 2 weeks. Jeff Teague has been god awful. Some of the young players have missed
every floater he's taken this season.
He's just looks terrible. I texted you the other day, change your number. He doesn't look good in 55.
I'm a little bit concerned that Jeff Teague has like ocular degeneration because he's like everything is short.
Yeah,
like, I think he can't see where the bat. Like he needs contacts or LASIK or something going on. Like his spatial awareness has not been good.
Not good for a basketball player. It's pretty important. You want to see where you're shooting. So we're almost a third of the way to the season, and they've had some nice wins, but then they followed up with how the hell did they lose to Detroit? There's one game that I can't get out of my mind was losing by 30 at home to the Knicks. Now the Knicks aren't as bad as they've been, but you don't lose to the Knicks by 30 at TD Garden if you're a real serious team. I know NBA teams have nights that they mail it in. Man, they really mailed it in that night. So they could maybe win a round, again, depending on where they fall. I can't see them being much better than the fourth seed of the East. If Brooklyn takes it seriously for a period of time, they'll elevate by the Celtics, and I don't think they're going to catch Milwaukee or Philadelphia. So if they're the fourth seed, who do you play in the first round? Indiana again? Yeah, they could beat Indiana, and then they play Philly in the next round, and they can't match up with Embiid.
Yeah, I do think they can beat Philly. They swept them last year. The roster is relatively similar. Better coach, better fit with Seth Curry in there. Mm-hmm. I think they're fully capable of beating Philly. They wouldn't be favored. But they've beaten them twice in the past 3 years in the playoffs, so you can't completely discount them beating the 76ers.
Embiid's a different player, though.
He's different. He's better. Yeah. You need to figure out whether it's through trade or free agency, something to try to slow him down a little bit. They don't have anybody who could defend Tatum is their issue. Because they won't put Simmons on him.
Right. Yeah, so Tatum could go for 30, but now if Simmons is on Brown, then Brown's
I'm saying it's not – it wouldn't – floor me if they beat.
No, I don't think Philadelphia is. No, yeah, I don't think Philadelphia is a lock. Because
I think if I'm the Celtics,
you hope to play them because you've beat them two out of the last.
I'd rather play them than Milwaukee or Brooklyn.
Yeah, those are not good matchups. Yeah, because Giannis they can't deal with it.
So if I'm picking my poison amongst those top Eastern teams from the Celtics, I'm hoping to get, like you said, like Indiana in the first round, maybe.
Yep.
And then get the Sixers in the second.
Let Brooklyn and Milwaukee fight it out in the 2-3 matchup. And
see where you go from there.
The thing with Embiid is he's the one NBA player that could go all Josh Beckett and put 20 pounds on during the season. Like, you don't generally see NBA players.
You have to game plan. You have to force him to run defensively.
Right.
You got to force him to play defensively. You can't let him just do nothing. And it's hard when you don't have any good bigs offensively.
Nope. No, you don't.
I don't know how far the Celtics can go because I'm obviously biased. I think it's all going to depend on matchup. I do think that their tandem of Brown and Tatum matches up with almost any two-person tandem in the league. They're that good. Kemba has been an issue. I mean, he can't shoot. His shooting numbers are horrible. I mean, look at the percentages. They're terrible. And if he can't hit open shots, they're not going anywhere. So it's going to really come down to him. If Kemba is dangerous, then the Celtics are a really hard out. If he's not, they're going to leave early, and they're going to have a lot of thinking to do in the offseason. Let's go to the West and do we'll do two teams in the West to wrap it up. Let's talk about the Western Conference leading Utah Jazz, who actually meet the Celtics later tonight in about 2 hours. How far can the Jazz go?
Tough conference, right? I mean, we both agree that the Lakers and the Clippers are the two best teams. Denver, which had a nice run last year getting to the conference finals, they haven't really got the traction going yet, but I think they eventually will. Two teams that I think are overachieving is Golden State and San Antonio, right? But San Antonio's doing a great job. And again,
yeah, other than Popovich, I'm not sure how they're doing it.
I don't know how they're doing it, but
sucks.
But that could be the answer to the question is Popovich, obviously. And Golden State, you know, Steph's having a great year, and you know, they could be the 4-5 seed, but it looks like Lakers and Clippers. As far as Utah, Utah has kind of a feel of the Atlanta Hawks from 5-6 years ago, where they would end up with the best record in the East, win 60 games, have 3 or 4 all-stars somehow, right? I mean, it was a year they had 4 yep. all-stars. Kyle Korver, Teague, Horford, and was it Joe Johnson was an all-star? I forget.
Yeah,
they had 4 all-stars.
Joe Johnson, was it past the Josh Smith era? I don't remember.
I think so. They had 4 all-stars in the game, and they had like 60 wins, and then they lost to Cleveland. They got swept in the second round.
Yeah.
Because, and that kind of what Utah looks like. They're well-coached. Quinn Snyder is a phenomenal coach. He's one of the 5 best coaches in the league. They bring it every night. They play really good defense. They're versatile. And in this kind of weird schedule where you're playing the same team back-to-back, you know, that coaching can really be a big difference. But then when you get into a 7-game series, like, what the hell are they going to do with the Lakers? Like, I mean,
well, look at this right now, Sep. If the season ended today, Utah's the 1 seed, Denver's yep. the 8 seed. I would pick Denver in that series.
I could see Denver absolutely winning that. Yeah, Gobert, you know, Rudy Gobert is a really good player, but, you know, Joker's better. And then you have a Murray, you know, mano a mano against Donovan
Denver
Mitchell.
Won that series last year. They won the
Denver
bubble.
Won it last year, yeah. So, and again, yeah, I could see that. That could definitely be an 8 upsetting a 1. And then if they advance past that, I mean, who knows what's going to happen over the next 2 to 3 months. But, you know, I don't think Golden State's more than a 1-round winning team as is San Antonio. So they could get there. But they can't beat the Lakers or the Clippers in a series.
No, I don't think Utah, I think their ceiling is getting to the second round. The Warriors' ceiling to me is getting into the playoffs and losing the
right.
first round.
Yeah,
the Jazz can't get to the conference finals. I don't see it. I don't see how
unless,
they can do it.
Unless the Clippers play the Lakers in the second round and they avoid that. And then they play, if they get by, say, Denver, and then they play, whether it be Portland or San Antonio or whatever. But again, they're well coached. They get everything out of themselves in the regular season, but they don't have a ceiling or they don't have like another punch to go to the way these other teams do. And again, I just compare them to the Atlanta Hawks of 5-6 years ago, where they'd be the number 1 seed and get swept by LeBron in the second round. I could see that happening.
What'll bite them is that they don't have enough scoring.
They
have one guy who can put up a lot of points.
Yep. Yeah. Jamal Murray's Donovan Mitchell's a great player. He's a sensational player.
I like Conley a lot. I like Gobert. Yep. Conley, you know, you could try to sneak 25 points out of him. Gobert, yep. you'd be lucky to get 20. I mean, he's just not a scorer. He's got 13 a game.
Yeah.
When you don't have when you can double team or triple team a guy like Donovan Mitchell, and then you have to rely on, you know, the other guys to score enough points to win you a game in the playoffs, I think that's a very tall ask.
Yeah. What's Donovan Mitchell, who's what, 6'1? Maybe 6'2? You know,
I mean, he can be great in the playoffs. I mean, he could go for 40, 50, and he very well might, but they could be in losing efforts.
But against the Clippers or the Lakers, you've got lockdown defenders, and they don't have to cover them the entire game. We saw last year against Denver, Jamal Murray was hot. LeBron got on him, shut him down. We know Kawhi or Paul George could do these types of things as well. I mean, the Lakers and Clippers, their calling card is their defense, which is always there when it needs to be. So, yeah, I mean, I think Utah is going to have a great regular season. Quinn Snyder is probably the leading candidate for coach of the year. They got wonderful players. It's a great story, but they don't quite have the cachet or the juice to get to the next level.
It would be weird. You know, it's a very possible NBA finals. That's the Lakers or the Clippers against the Nets, which would be like sort of a Super Bowl matchup of like the great offense against the great defense that you really don't get in the NBA. Cause most of the time, the teams that get to the NBA Finals are like top five in both efficiencies, offensive mm-hmm. and defensive. The Nets will be like one in offensive efficiency and like 28 in defensive efficiency. They are an interesting team. I know we've talked ad nauseum about them, but there's going to be a lot more interesting stuff going on with the Nets. So that's it for today's show, Sap. Plenty to talk about today as we got to lots of stuff. I'm sure there will be lots of stuff by the next time we get around to this, which will be either later in the week or early next week. Maybe we'll know how more clarity on the All-Star game. Maybe LeBron James and Chris Paul will put out a joint statement of reconciliation. I don't know. We'll have to see. That's what's great about the NBA is you never know what the next day's news cycle will bring. We are the Pick and Roll NBA podcast with Jet and Sap. We are presented by Full Press Coverage. Remember to seek out our podcast on fullpresscoverage.com on Spotify. I'll tweet it out from my Twitter, which is at Jet Stryer. Sap, how can people find you?
At John Sap 25, JohnSap, and the number 25.
All right, and that's how you can find both of us. We will make sure that the link is tweeted out, and so you can follow us for our content every week. Thank you for listening. Make sure, again, to find us. As always, we are the Pick and Roll NBA podcast, Shin Sap, presented by Full Press Coverage.